ऑप्टिमाइजेशन टेक्निक। टुडे वी विल स्टार्ट विद दिस सब्जेक्ट एलपीपी और यू कैन कॉल एज द लीनियर प्रोग्रामिंग प्रॉब्लम एंड द फर्स्ट लेक्चर इज ऑन व्हाई वी नीड दिस एलपीपी इन द ऑप्टिमाइजेशन टेक्निक। माय सेल्फ डॉक्टर गर्ग वर्किंग इन द स्कूल ऑफ मैथमेटिक्स थापर इंस्टीट्यूट इंडिया। यू कैन कॉन्टेक्ट मी बाय ईदर ऑफ माई ईमेल आई डीज इफ यू फील एनी डाउट रिलेटेड टू दिस ऑप्टिमाइजेशन टेक्निक सब्जेक्ट और एल्स यू कैन सिंपली क्लिक ऑन दिस लिंक एंड देन फाइंड द प्ले लिस्ट रिलेटेड टू द ऑप्टिमाइजेशन टेक्निक्स for this course. So what is the optimization problem or optimization technique is there? So sometimes the operation research, which is usually called in the UK, while in the operational research in the US, is nothing a interdisciplinary branch of the mathematics. So it's a branch of the mathematics are there which usually use these three properties are there or these three subjects are there. First one is the mathematical modeling, that is you have to model the problem. How you model the problem, that is the mathematical problem. For example, if you want to buy a mobile phone, then what is your objective function is there, then what's your target, you want to maximize or you want to minimize the some parameters of the mobile, and some constraints are there, like say budget is there, how you can handle the budget so that you can able to grasp your mobile according to your own features. So these are certain problems are there. So that is how you model the problems in terms of their mathematics. Second is the statistics are there. Once you are defining this, then you are able to make a decision, to a good decision or bad decision depending upon their different algorithms you achieve them. So far, before studying this course, you already know that you have also studied in your first year calculus that several kind of the optimization problems are there. First one is the differential calculus, which was initially proposed by Newton. So what is the differential calculus that you already used in the differential calculus related to the optimization? That if you want to optimize this function, how you maximize or minimize that? You firstly take the derivative zero and then you can get the value of the x. After that, you can check whether second derivative is a greater than zero or less than zero according to their maximization or minimization problem. So that calculus is used in terms of the optimization by Newton. After that, you have studied the Lagrange are there, that is a functional or the constraint problems, which was initially proposed by this, that is a famous Lagrange are there. After that, you may analyze what is the direct substitution or the steepest descent methods are there for finding the solution, which was initially proposed by Cauchy. Later on, the Euler, which you also studied in terms of the functional or the calculus of variance, that how to optimize the function with the help of this calculus of variance and the minimization function, which was initially defined by Euler. After that, you might heard about the differential calculus, like say if your function is say u into v, then how you differentiate that, that is the first function, derivative of second, first and so on. Similarly, you can calculate the second derivative and third and so on. But how you calculate the nth derivative of the function this, with the help of this Leibniz theorem is there. So all of you know about the differential calculus. Same task is you can apply for the optimization. Now my task is to explain what is the LPP, which is the course of this optimization technique. So LPP is defined as the linear programming problem. So main task is what is the linear function? So if I just ask you what is the linear function, so what is the linear function? So I just ask from you, what is the linear function? So might be that these are the two definitions which usually came in your mind. A function whose degree is one or a function whose graph is a straight line is called as the linear function. So based on this definition, can I say this mod x is a linear function? All of you know that mod x is a non-linear. This is a non-linear function. But if you think about that, what is the degree of this? It is 1, but it is a non-linear. So it means the definition of this is not exactly same. So what you can say that, is it a linear or non-linear? So all of you know that mod x is a non-linear function. Similarly, if you consider this second function, which is of the two variable, is this function with respect to the x1 only is a linear? What is the degree of the x1 is? 1. So you can say it's a linear or non-linear. Now, how can you check that whether the function, whether this or any other are they linear or non-linear? For this, you always, in order to check whether the function is a linear or non-linear, you always try to calculate their derivative. For example, what is the derivative of the mod x? What is the derivative of mod x? All of you know that this is the derivative of mod x. Now look at this function. What is the domain? What is the domain of this mod x? Since it is nothing is given, so it means this is belong to the real line. So when it is belong to the real line, you can choose any value from the real line. You may choose x as a minus 7, you may choose x as a minus 100, you can choose x as a 7, 73, x as a 10 to the power 4, and so on, because it all belongs to the real line. So what will happen if you choose x as a minus 7, then what's the answer of this? This is minus 7 upon minus 7 mod, that is minus 7 over plus 7, minus 1. So the answer of this is minus 1. Similarly, if you choose x as a minus of 100, then the answer will be minus 100 upon plus 100, again minus 1. What is the answer of the plus 1? This is plus 1. So you can say that this is nothing but if whenever x is less than 0, the answer is minus 1. X is positive, then it's a 1. Now, can you say that the derivative, you can say the rate of change in this case is a constant over the domain? Is it constant over the domain? So what is the domain of this function is? Real line. So this is not a constant, because if someone choose a number which is negative, then the value is a minus 1 and otherwise plus. So it means it changes. Or you can say if someone choose a plus 4, then the rate of change is plus 1. If someone choose as in minus of 9, then a rate of change is minus 1. Now, since the rate of change is not a constant, so you can say a function whose rate of change is not a constant called as a nonlinear function. So hence, this function is my nonlinear. So the simple procedure is that you have to check whether the function is a linear or nonlinear. You always try to calculate their derivative. If the derivative is a constant quantity over the domain, then it's a linear, otherwise not. Look at one more example. Look at that, whether this mod x, x greater than 2 is a linear or nonlinear. So since you want to check whether it's a linear or nonlinear, you want to calculate the derivative. So what is the derivative of this? Again, it's x by mod x. Now what is the domain is? Greater than 2. So whatever that you have to choose, it means you can't take x as a minus 3 because it is not belong to the real over the domain. Therefore, you can choose x as a 3, you can choose x as a 4.5, you can choose x as a 7.9 and so on. So whatever the domain, whatever the value of the x you chosen from the domain, what's the answer of this? This is always 1. This is for all x belong to the domain. So, or you can say for all x greater than 2. Look at that. This is always. So now, this is a constant quantity over this domain. So therefore, this is a linear function. So remember that this mod x, if nothing is given, if it is given to be the domain R, then it's a nonlinear. But if some domain is given, like say x is less than of say 3, so is it a linear or nonlinear? So whenever x is less than of 3 domain, then the derivative of mod x is again minus 1, always. This is always for those values which are satisfy this domain. Hence, this is a linear. Similarly, if you consider about this third example, now check whether this function is a linear with respect to x1 or not. Now, since this function is depending upon x1 and x2 both, but the question asked is only with respect to x1, so you can calculate their derivative. Since it consists of the two variables, so the derivative must be a partial. So what's the derivative is? 1. What's the domain of the x1 and x2 here is? This is over the all R2 plane. Now, this is a constant quantity. So since this is a constant quantity, whatever the pairs of the x1 and x2, this is always be a constant. So you can say this f is a linear function with respect to the x1. What will happen if you check whether this function is linear with respect to x2 or not? So what is the derivative of with respect to x2? So this is a 0, 0, and this is 8x2. Is it a constant quantity over the domain? So what is the domain is? It's a real line. Sorry, it's a plane. So if someone choose x2 as a 3, if someone choose x2 as a 4, then the answer will change. Look at that. Here in this case is 24, in this case is a 32, and then so on. So since this is changes, so you can say f is nonlinear with respect to the x2. Look at that. So since this is a constant for all the values of the x1, x2, so this is a linear. On the other hand, if you try to find is a nonlinear with respect to x2. Similarly, if I just consider one more example for you, say 2x1 minus of the 3x2, okay, and check whether this is a linear with respect to x1 or not. So what is the derivative of, okay, firstly I just consider the mode. So what is the derivative with respect to x1? So 2x1 minus 3x2 divided by, because what is the derivative of the mode is this into 2. Now what is the domain is for the R2? So what is the value of this? So now this is a constant. So what is the answer of this part? What is the answer of this part? It can be 1 or minus 1. Depending upon that, if 2x1 minus 3x2 is greater than 0 or 2x1 minus 3x2 is less than 0. So since this part is not a constant, if you multiply them 2, so what will be the answer is there? Either it will be 2 or it will be a minus 2, or lies between 2 and this whenever this is greater than 0 or this is. Now this is not a constant quantity. It's not a constant. So therefore this is my nonlinear. On the other hand, if I just consider one more example for you, say mod of 2x1 plus 3x2, and again, so what is the derivative with respect to x1? This is again 2x1 plus 3x2 divided by mod of this into 2. So what is the answer of this? So can this numerator part be greater than or less than 0? Yes, obvious that, because there is no domain provided. So whenever x1 and x2 both are less than 0, so this quantity will be negative. And whenever x1 and x2 are greater than 0, this quantity will always be positive. Also, if x1 is greater than 0, x2 is less than 0, then it can be positive or it can be negative depending upon the values of the x1 and x2. Therefore, what you conclude that the pair this is changes for different values of the x1 and x2. Now, since this is a changes, so it is a nonlinear with respect to x1. Similarly, you can check that this is a nonlinear with respect to x2. Hence, this function is nonlinear with respect to x1, nonlinear with respect to x2. So we call as this is a nonlinear function. Last example, if I just ask you the same one, if I say 2x1 plus 3x2 of mod, and whenever x1 and x2 are my greater than 0. So what is the derivative of this with respect to say x1? It will be my 2 times of this. Now check whether this is a linear or nonlinear. Now here the domain is all those positive quantities. So this value will always be a plus 1. Now since this is a constant quantity, so now therefore this is a linear function. So based on this linear and nonlinear, what are the phases of the operation research or optimization technique? What we will study in this course is, firstly, we have to formulate the problem. How to formulate the problem, that we will be discussed. Once you will formulate the problem, you have to construct their model. And then once you construct their model, then you have to look at their possible solutions. And out of all those solutions, you have to check for their optimal solution. So this is the phases which we will be follow in this course. What is the mathematical optimization problem? So look at that. Our task is to formulate the problem and then construct their model. So how you formulate the problems? The basic task for any optimization problem is to either maximize or minimize the function subjected to this constraint. Now this constraint, look at that, the function f0 is my objective function. This g are called as my constraints, okay, and these are my design variables. The simple example is that if you want to buy something, okay, and if you want to buy a car, then what's your target is you want to maximize their fuel efficiency, okay. So what is the constraint? That's a budget. because you want a budget to be less than of the say 10 lakh. You want to buy a car whose price will be less than or equal to the 10 lakh. So this is my GX, and objective function is my maximize the fuel. So X is my decision variables. This is my here, and it must be the linear independent. We will see when we start this course what is the meaning of the linear independent, or else you already knows that in your calculus what is the meaning of the linear independent. Here G is called as the inequality constant because of this less than sign, and since this is a constraint, so that's why this is called as the constraint optimization problem. If you miss this line, then there is no constraint, then we call as the unconstrained optimization problem. And all of you know that if you want to solve this maximization problem, there is no need to solve the minimization problem separately, because if you see the graphically, if you want to find the minimum, this is the minimum value, and if you want to find, if you take the mirror image of this, this is the dotted line is a mirror image, and this is the maximum of this. So if I called this as my say y and this as my say z, so what you conclude that since this is my fx, this objective function is my minus f, so the minimum of f nothing but my y. What is that? This is my maximum of minus f is nothing but my z, and what is that? This is the distance is same, so you can call as y as nothing but my minus of z. So therefore minimum of f is nothing but my minus of maximum of, and this is true for all the functions are there. So there is no need to find minimum or maximum separately. Once you are finding the maximization problem, you can easily find the minimization value. So minimum of fx is same as that of the minus of the fx in magnitude. Otherwise you have to take the negative of this as here. Now in your calculus, in your first year, you have already discussed several type of the optimization problem, like first derivative should be 0, second derivative less than greater than 0. So if you closely look at this graph, and you can see this blue color is called as the local minimum, and this red color as the global minimum. And all of you know what is the definition of the local minimum is, you have to find the point x0, so this point is my x0, in such a way that no other point, if you take the neighborhood of this x0 plus h, is whatever the sufficient small is there, it will not satisfy. So if I call as x star is my minimum point, then I can say that the function value at this is always be less than of those other points are there. So if this condition satisfied, then we call as the local. What is the global is? Irrespective of for all the values of the h. Here is the sufficient small positive and negative value of the h. But if you restrict the domain to be all those values of the h, then we call as the global are there. But here we will change the sign to be the greater than, so it is called as the maximum. So there is no this just change to be less than to be the greater than for the maximum or the minimum. Now in your calculus also you have seen how to find the maximum and the minimum of the function. There are the two conditions, one is a necessary and second is a sufficient. Necessary, you all of know that f dash is 0, and the sufficient is, instead of only calculating the f double dash, you have to find all those values at which the first non-zero derivative found. And if you find that the non-zero derivative is greater than 0 and n is my even, then we call it the minimum point. And else, if my non-zero derivative is an even number, here is my odd number. Then if it is even number, then it is a less than 0, then it's a maximization problem, and so on. Look at that one example. All of you know that how to maximize or minimize the function. So firstly, you have to find this as a necessary condition. First derivative, this, if you put them 0, the roots will be here. What is the second derivative? You can find this one. Now you check that whether this x 0, 1 or 2 is a maximum or minimum. You can substitute x0 here. What is the value of the first second derivative at x is equal to 0? If you substitute, you will get as a 0. If you substitute x as a 1, what you get? You will get as a minus 60, and then so on. But since f double dash is 0, so you can't say that whether it's a maximum or a minimum. So how you can, then you have to find there at x is equal to 0. Since this value is 0, so you can't say that. So you have to find the third derivative at x is equal to 0. So what is the value of the third derivative? Is you can check that it's a non-zero. Now this value, sorry, that's true. This is again the even number. And if this is even and it's a greater than sign, then it's a minimum. If it is even and it's a less than sign, then it's a maximum. And if it is odd, then it's a neither maximum nor minimum. So you can see that this 3 is my odd number and it's a non-zero. So that's why this is a neither maximum nor minimum. Look at that. The second derivative is less than 0. And this second is my even number and it's a less than sign. So it's a maximum and minimum. So this all of you are well known about your 10 plus 2 or the other classes are there. Similarly, if you try to solve this, and all of you see that these are the non-linear speed. So similarly, you can take the first partial derivative, you can find the roots are there, you can find the stationary points, then you can find this Hessian matrix. What is that? How you calculate? This is the second derivative with respect to the x1. This is the second derivative with respect to the x1, x2. This is the second derivative with respect to the x2, x1. And this is the second derivative with respect to the x2 square. All of you remember that this is a11, a12, a21, a22. So here 11 means x1 square. x12 means x1, x2. So once you will solve, you will get here. Now you can substitute one by one point here. And how, since this is the matrix, so you have to define the size of matrix is 2 cross 2. So you have to define the two matrix. One is for the 1 cross 1. With the first diagonal entries, and the D2 means the second diagonal 2 cross 2 matrix with the two second diagonal entries. Now you can substitute 0 comma 0 in these two cases. This is the determinant. So once you find 0 comma 0, you can find the value of the D1 as a plus 4. Look at that, plus 4. This is the determinant of this. What's the value of the 0 0 is 4 0 0 8. What's the determinant is 32. You can see, and similarly for the other side. Now, what is that? Remember that the rule is first derivative, if it is greater than second derivative greater than 0, then it is minimum. Second derivative less than 0, it's a maximum. So greater than 0 means positive sign. So look at that. These are the positive, these are the positive, and others are negative. So out of these two points, either one of them is a minimum. But since it is a positive sign always, so second one is also be positive. If all those D1 and D2 are positive, we call as the minimum. On the other hand, for the maximum side, if you consider the second derivative, one is a negative, then is a positive, then a negative, first is positive, provided first one is a less than sign because of the maximum. Is there any value? Yes, it's a negative, it's a positive, so it's a maximum. And all the other cases are their saddle point, neither maximum nor minimum. Look at that, plus minus, opposite signs are there, but we need opposite signs only for this. Start with the negative. So this condition not satisfied. This is a saddle point. And these are again both are the negative, but we want if the first one is negative, other one is a positive. So this is again the saddle point. Now this is all about you have to study it in your calculus, in your mathematics one and so on. Now why we need the LPP in this optimization technique? Why we study this subject? So can you solve this problem with the help of this traditional calculus? Can you find the first derivative 0, find the value of the x1 and so on? You can't. Why? Because look at that. If you calculate only for the objective function, what is that? 4. What is that? 3. Minus 3. It can't be 0. You can't find the value of the x1 and x2 from here. That's why this method, that's the first derivative 0, second derivative less than greater than 0, is not applicable for the linear programming problem. Because look at that. Whether this function is linear or not, what is the rate of change is 4. This is a constant. So this is a linear. Again, it's a linear. Look at the constants. What is the derivative with respect to x1 is 2, constant and so on. In order to handle this, that is a linear programming and we will study the simplex methods. This dentist will be proposed in 1914 for solving this linear programming. Later on, this Bellman will discuss about the dynamic programming. And this Koo and Kuk are there, will discuss the necessary and the sufficient condition for this programming problem. The basic idea behind this is about the convex set. I will not discuss detail in this today lecture. We will see. I just give you the simple idea about that. if this is a shaded portion, you can consider any two point in the shaded region, and if you join them, are this line segment is again in the shaded portion? If yes, then we call it the convex set. Look at this. You can take any two point in the shaded region. If you join them, so yes, this all are lies in this shaded portion. But if you consider this and here, if you join them, look at that. These points are lies outside the shaded region. So that's why this is called as the non-convex set. So since this property holds for all those points, similarly, you can see if you consider any two point here, this is the convex set because it again lies in the shaded portion. So that's our view step. So the general formulation of the LPP is that you have to define this objective function, which is either maximize or minimize, C1, X1, C2, X2, and where CIs are the constant. These are the constraints. Either greater than, less than sign are there. It can be one constant or more than one. Or you can write in terms of, like say, this is CX. You can write this as a matrix, like what is the A11, A12, and then so on. And X1 up to Xn. And here, so I can write in terms of the matrix as Ax is here, while x is greater than 0. So these are the three equations. Now, once you, this is the formulation of the LPP. Once you will formulate the LPP, then your task is to find the solution. So what is the meaning of this solution is, you have to find the value of the x which satisfy only the equation number 2. Forget about the 1 and 3rd. If any x which satisfy equation number 2 only, we call as the solution. What is the meaning of the feasible solution is, if satisfy the second as well as third both, then we call it the feasible solution. And optimal solution is, all those feasible solution, if it exists more than one, you can substitute the value in this, the value of the x in one, and based on the task of the maximum or minimum, you can find this optimal solution. Look at the one example. So I consider you can easily draw the graphical methods are there, and if you want to shade them, this is the shading portion. Okay, so look at that. If I just consider here, what is the point of this? I consider 7,3. Can this 7,3 is a solution? How can you check that is a solution or not? What is the definition is? The solution means which satisfy the constraint. This is my equation number 2. This is equation number 1. This is equation number 3. So can 7,3 satisfy this? Look at the first one is 7 plus 3 greater than 5, satisfied. 21 plus 3 greater than, yes. So you can say, yes, this is a solution. Is it the feasible? Yes, because 7 and 3 both are greater than 0. So it's a feasible also. So can you find the optimal solution? You can substitute all those points in here. How many points lies in this feasible region? Infinite many. So therefore, you can't find the maximum value. That's why this is the unbounded region. Similarly, for this example, if you see, can this point be this solution, is a feasible solution or the optimal solution? So can is a feasible solution or is a solution? You have to check that from this equation number 2. Since both are satisfied, x1 is my minus 3 by 2, x2 is here. So first one satisfied. Second one is a plus 9 by 2, minus 3 by 2, again satisfied. So yes, this is a solution. Can this be the feasible solution? No. Why? Because we need to satisfy equation number 3rd also. So since both, at least one of them is also not satisfied, so it is not a feasible. So once it is not a feasible, so it can never be the optimal. So look at that. If you want to move in, this is the point of an intersection. This is the solution, but not the feasible solution. So that's the main motivation behind this LPP, why we need in the optimization technique, because look at that. Once we will try to solve, we will try to find the optimal solutions through the feasible and the solution. And the classical methods like F double dash or F this does not work in case of the feasible solution or in the LPP. So what are the various methods related to this optimization technique? Not for the LPP, but for the optimization techniques are classified at here. And in this course, we will see about these, all those red dots we will discuss in this optimization techniques course. So remember that our task is to formulate the optimization problem firstly, then construct the model, and then solve. So I just give the brief idea in the last slide that how you formulate the problem, that is, you have to maximize or minimize the function like this way, subjective to some constraints, and the non-negativity is there. and you have to check whether it's a linear or nonlinear. Once you will define the linear or nonlinear, then you have to define the solutions. So possible solution means that's a type of the solution. One is the solution, then feasible solution, then optimal solution. We will see the detailed description of all these 4 points in this course. And finally, once you will find this, then your target is to find the optimal solution. And all of you have solved easily with the help of the graphical method in your childhood classes. So how you formulate the problem, that we will discuss, we will start this course from the next lecture, that how to formulate the problem, that will be here. You can, if there is any doubt, you can ask me at any time, there is no problem about that, but make sure that we will discuss about the linear programming problem. You can watch the other videos if you want to find through this link that is related to this optimization techniques course. This. Till then, happy learning, best of luck.